Welcome to another Treasure Tuesday. That's right, Reiser's Treasure Hunting Emporium's live stream. That's right, coins, metal detecting, and history. I tell you what, gang, keep your hands and feet inside the car at all times. Anyway, gang, we'll see who's here. Oh, there's Yeoman Gull. Hey, Yeoman, how are you? American Willard Brooks. Hi, hi. Belinda Hughes. Hi, Mrs. AWR. Blended Whiskey. Hi, hi. And I tell you what, the gang is all rolling in. North Jersey Detector, hello, Willie, hi, hi. Oh, there's Ghost Talk with the Riser. That gal, she follows me everywhere. Willie, hey, there's Oz. Hey, Ozzy, Darren, how are you? Finders Keepers, hi, hi. And welcome again to the live stream. Hey, there's Wild Bill. Hey, Wild Bill. And I tell you what, welcome one and all to the live stream this evening, believe it or not. And anyway, gang, I tell you, hey, there's Field Guy. Hey, Field Guy, how are you? And David Carlisle, hey, hey, all right, Tim Holmes, how are you? Bacon. And I tell you what, gang, welcome to another live stream. That's right, it's another Treasure Tuesday. Hey, there's Mike B. Hey, Mike B, how are you? And I tell you what, welcome again, like I said, to the live stream. Michael Mullins, how are you? And I tell you what, Jersey History Hunters, hello, hello. Hey, there's Michael Kittle, Rare Coins, hi, hi. And Hoogie's Hobby Shop, hi, hi. All right, gang, well, here we go. I tell you what, welcome to another edition of Reiser's Treasure Hunting Emporium live stream. Dare I say it? That's right, I dare. The only live stream you'll see tonight that talks about George Washington's bedpan. That's right, George Washington's bedpan. See that? Poo. That's right, poo can be patriotic. Well, if you just put your mind to it, anyway. Anyway, I tell you what, such a neglected part of history, poop, and you know, it could be the very reason why the Declaration of Independence has such a variety of signatures. Now, let me give you a look at here as far as what we're talking about. And, there. But yeah, gang, that's right. John Hancock, large, bold, neat. I tell you what, gang, he went to the restroom beforehand. I tell you, he was relaxed and content. And but anyway, this other guy, Stephen Hopkins, however, his signature looks like he had to go to the bathroom and bed. That's right. I tell you, he was in the in a hurry to use the facilities. You know, he's probably nudging Ben Franklin. Ben, hurry your old self up and sign the paper. I gotta go. But anyway, gang, I tell you what, I wonder if any of the representatives of the then colonies put the colon in colon, I don't know. You know, I wonder if they pranked each other in the outhouse, you know, kind of tipped it over or whatnot, I don't know. But anyway, gang, all right, enough of the potty humor. And in case you are truly curious about Stephen Hopkins' signature, in all seriousness, he was troubled with some paralytic issues and had to use his left hand to guide his right hand when writing. And I tell you what, wonderful bit of minutia. And I tell you what, break down the history. That's right, break the history down. Not only explore the reasonings and the purposes of that history, but, you know, ask questions. Why is this man's signature somewhat sloppy? Was it fear? You know, because basically they were going to be basically tried for treason if, things didn't go well. You know, so was it a shaky hand or fear, or did he have to go to the potty? And with a little bit of research, we can build a better picture, make that two-dimensional history into three-dimensional. And I tell you what, you know, perhaps even visualize the moment clearer inside our mind's eye. And but anyway, that's right, Mr. Hopkins was affirmed, and who knows, he may have required the most time to sign the document. And I tell you, whether researching history or researching a metal detecting spot, pay attention to the minutiae. It will provide a clearer picture of the past and provide an additional link to take your research further. Well, anyway, I think that was probably the long-winded anyway, introduction we've ever had to the live stream. But anyway, I tell you, I think that's the longest introduction we have had yet. Anyway, hey, there's Miss Paula, hi, Miss Linda Wallace, hi, and welcome in, and I'll let it slide this time, anyway, gang, I tell you, welcome again to the stream, and anyway, hey, there's KP, and there's Miss Diane, hi, and I tell you what. But anyway, gang, that's my little bit. Hey, there's Marty. Hi, Marty. Anyway, gang. All right, well, enough of Stephen Hopkins, and we'll get him out of here. And real quick, we're going to do a couple quick announcements. And first thing first, happy birthday. Okay, all right, happy birthday. All right. Okay, we did that one. All right, and this announcement. All right. This announcement, mugs for mugs. I tell you what, gang, thanks for whoever bought a mug. And for those folks who ordered and I tell you what, in for the mugs for mugs campaign, it basically is a mugs for mugs giveaway. Basically, you take your picture with your mug and send it to Reiser, let me use it, and I'll enter you in for a silver round giveaway. Now, you have until July the 19th to get me the photo, and the giveaway for the silver round will be done on Tuesday, July 23rd's live stream. And again, thanks for everyone who has purchased the mug. And also, too, we made it over a little threshold, and we will be, that same live stream, the July 23rd live stream, will be giving away, over there, we'll be giving away a mug in celebratory fashion since we made it over that 1500 mark. So yeah, do tune in for that. But anyway, gang, tonight, this evening, meaning tonight, we've got Cipher Talk. That's right. We have received a Cipher from Rivendell Coins, and we'll be going over it. And also, too, we already did the upcoming. Treasure in the News. Oh, boy, we've got an article for you coming up. I tell you what, we just can't get away from poop. That's right. We'll have an up-close and personal look at Founding Fathers George Washington's bedpan. How close do you really want to get to a bedpan? I mean, if it's clean, or a chamber pot, you know, if it's clean, why, you'd be okay, but I don't know how close, if it was just like recently used, I don't know. But wouldn't it be amazing if they found traces of poo still inside? No, okay, that's not. But anyway, gang, also too, tonight we have a viewer appreciation giveaway. Oh, you're looking down there at the bottom at it. Tonight we have a coin necklace donated by Miss Linda Wallace, and we also have a colonial flat button, and also too, that's right, a packet of Reiser's Treasure Hunting Emporium toilet paper. That's right, it goes wherever you go, for when you have to, you know it, go. And then, gang, I tell you what, that there, I think that makes a show. But anyway, hey, welcome in, if you're strolling in. Hey, there's Tin Cup Tim, hi. And anyway, gang, I tell you. Hey, there's Ambient, hi, Ambient. And dude, do it. Oh, okay. Hey, Mike, how are you? And Z, how are you doing, Z? And anyway, gang. All right, well, I tell you what, we'll get this train on the track. Now, we'll get some more photos up here for you to look at. And, that thing. All right, now, a couple of weeks ago, via email, I received a cipher. That's right, a puzzle of sorts from Rivendell Coins. Now, for you folks who have been watching for a spell, know that we do this to torment one another. Well, okay, not really.
Are you sure it's to torment each other, or is it to torment me?
Could be both. But anyway, I tell you what, like any type of physical exercise, one should also exercise one's noggin. And I tell you what, gang, with Riv Cipher, in exercise it was. In fact, I think I pulled something. But anyway, I'll have to get some icy hot for my brain. But anyway, gang, the ciphers are great, great fun. And if you happen to have missed Rivendell Coins' live stream decoding my last cipher volley, be sure and check it out. It was on last Friday. It's always neat to see the powers of an individual's mind, the acute use of deduction, and Rivendell Coins is very, very adept at it. Also, in that live stream, Esmeralda, she makes an appearance in that live stream. And speaking of Esmeralda, we had to take a second look at that footage, because we do believe that there may have been something supernatural about it. And here, have a look.
Because we go back to the coins, right? And Jason, you had an idea for... Oh my God, Jason!
Oh my God, Jason!
So anyway, I don't know if you saw it, but I don't know, it was something kind of off. Anyway, so anyway, gang, this is Rivendell's volley back to me. Now, when I first looked at it, my brain initially tries to cheat. You know, I tell you what, sometimes this hurts more than it helps. The word coins in the second column runs upside down vertically, and also too, horizontally, the last row has all the letters required for RTHETP. Now, at first, I thought, you know, it was an anomaly. And the second, unfortunately, The first coins I thought was an anomaly. And the second, unfortunately, at that time, I thought was also an anomaly as well. And I really wish I stuck to my guns looking at it. But anyway, for a week, it was a welcome diversion. You know, it gave my brain something to think about besides life and whatnot, and was a welcomed distraction. And as with most ciphers, one must establish the key. Basically, the key is an item that is an important catalyst for the solution of the cipher. Now, being picture-oriented, I noticed the pictures in the four corners of the page. You know, we got a skull and crossbones, and it got a Celtic cross, gravestone, a shovel, and a crown. Now, hints they are, and not mere decorations. And I'm also on the lookout for any type of red herrings, you know, devices purposely used to distract from the true clue. True clue. We can rhyme. True clue. But anyway, however, you will come to see that all of the pictured elements are indeed relevant. And because all basically the shovel, the skull and crossbones, the gravestone, you know, that kind of actually has something to do with my channel and Sandy's channel. But you know what? The crown is what was kind of throwing me off with it. Because the crown, kind of doesn't fit. But I tell you what. So, you know, kind of like, what's with the crown? But anyway, the phrase. Here we have two Charlie, a fellow of infinite jest. Now uncover the key to decipher the message. All right, that phrase in there just runs through my mind. A fellow of infinite jest. Who talks like that? I don't know. Even for Rivendell coins, who talks like that? Could it be the shovel? Well, I'm getting ahead of myself. And the letters. I tell you what, gang, when I first looked at this, you know, could it be a Caesar shift cipher? Or, basically each letter representing a different letter, or a 90-degree shift cipher, where the message is actually in code, however it is written so the message's letters will turn and hence make a box, you know, kind of like how you see the letters in a box form here. But anyway, gang, due to life and responsibilities, I had to set it aside, but it was always at arm's reach. A fellow of infinite jest. Who talks like that? I don't know. But anyway, gang, a couple days passed, and I restarted my looking at the cipher, jotting down different possibilities, and even making a copy of statistics for letter usage. I ran through several different perceived possibilities and even equations, and one thing that lodged in my head, the letter Y. The letter Y is indeed the letter Y. That sounds really profound now, don't it? But anyway, basically what I'm trying to get at is the letter Y, even if it was ciphered, that letter Y always came back to being a letter Y. And it was, I have to admit, it was driving me nuts a little bit. But anyway, so the letter Y being the letter Y, basically told me one of two things. Either a word was the key to the shift of letters, and eventually the letters worked themselves out to where the Y was the Y, or it's not a Caesar cipher at all, but possibly a column transposition. And basically it's where the columns get rearranged to form the message. Now, before I could get into any of these theories, life again got in the way. But that same evening, when I was kind of mulling it over, while I was doing something completely unrelated, I was writing something, and I happened to write an analogy of something coming and going, and, you know, and I made the analogy like Hamlet's ghost. Well, as soon as that went through my brain about Hamlet's ghost, I grabbed that cipher, ignoring all else I was supposed to be doing, and a fellow of infinite jest. That's right, a fellow of infinite jest. Who talks like that? Well, let me tell you who. William Shakespeare does, and did. Or he did. He doesn't anymore. He doesn't really say too much. He's rather a quiet fellow anymore. But William Shakespeare's Hamlet. And this phrase appears in Act 5, Scene 1. And the line actually reads, Horatio, a fellow of infinite jest. Now, I had something to work with. Oh, yeah. And the next day I was attempting to plug in keywords to unscramble the cipher ladders. You know, I still wasn't abandoning the shift idea. But no matter what keyword I attempted to use, I could not get the statistic frequency of letters to fall into place. Basically, you know, you always want to see the E being used the most frequently, followed by A, and etc. Well, I couldn't get the... Oh, yeah, Ken. I could not get those letters to align themselves. So anyway, and I went back to that first initial thought of the why is the why. And I tell you what, after that, I thought perhaps the rest of the letters are indeed what they are. So basically, I made a photocopy of the cipher and cut the columns into strips. And I wasn't sure if I needed to use the bottom empty boxes that you see that are empty. And I did get a clarification. You know, I talked to Rivendell coins back and forth when we're doing it. And of course, we will always laugh at one another when we're trying to attempt to solve each other's ciphers. But anyway, gang, I tell you what, for whatever reason, I could not get that shift solution out of my head. But anyway, so I cut the strips and starting to rearrange. But anyway, that evening, I started thinking about Hamlet and was trying to remember the characters, and I did have to do a quick review. We got Gravediggers, Ophelia, Hamlet, Horatio, Larry Rates. I can never remember or say that guy's name. So, I always gave him a nickname of Larry. And then, gang, of course, that's right. As Ken said earlier, York. Now, York was the court jester of Hamlet's father. And as soon as I saw that name, my eyes shot to the paper. And I tell you what, gang, I knew those top row letters almost by heart. And again, because of that dumb Y, I could not get that Y out of my head. But rearranged, it would indeed spell Yorick. Oh, the strain. I tell you what, serves me right for not remembering the jester's name. Rearranged, this is what one has. Basically, at the top, you have Yorick. And then the message, what Chinese coin is a good match for RTHE, Reiser Strasure Hunting Emporium, toilet paper? All right, gang, well, we have the answer for that. And here, have a look at it. That's right, it is the hoopoo. That's right, the coin that is indeed a perfect match for Reiser's Treasure Hunting Emporium toilet paper. But I tell you what, you know, it serves me right for not keeping up with my Shakespeare. And here, you know what? Here's the end of the segment.
Brush up your Shakespeare. Start quoting him now. Brush up your Shakespeare, and the women you will bow.
If your girl is a Washington Heights dream,
treat the kid to a Midsummer's Night dream.
If she fights when her clothes you are mussing,
what a clothes much ado about nothing.
If she says your behavior is heinous,
kick her right in the
Coriolanus.
Brush up your Shakespeare, and they'll all kowtow.
Now,
and they're all
cow.
And they'll all cow as budget.
Anyway, gang, yeah, that was from Kiss Me, Kate. And Brush Up Your Shakespeare. Now, if you guys ever seen that play, actually live, and that's, you know, of course, the old Hollywood version from, I think, 1952. If you ever see that play live, that's actually a very dirty song. And by the way, we'll do a little ad, a little promo for Broadway right now. They got actually quite a few revival plays. They actually got Kiss Me, Kate going on right now on Broadway, Carousel, and Oklahoma, all at the same time. So anyway, if you happen to be in the New York City area, do catch one of those. I tell you what, I think I would like to go see Oklahoma. And but anyway, there you have it. Uh-oh. You're out of my will again, North Jersey. Oh, jeez. What'd you do? But anyway. James Whitmore. Hey, all right, Will. Well, that's right. And Keenan Wynn was the other guy. And Keenan Wynn was the son of vaudevillian Edwin. And if you remember the Edwin, I know he's probably trying to struggle for who Edwin is. Edwin was, if you ever saw the Absent Minded Professor, Edwin was the fire chief. When, yeah. Yeah. But anyway, actually, Keenan Wynn was in that too. So that was actually a father and son scene now I think about it. Well, anyway. Hoo-poo. Anyway, gang. All right. Moving right along. All right. Well, onwards. Well, all right. Well, time for tonight's history segment. And I tell you what, gang. If I have it here, I do have it. Time for tonight's history segment. Now, as I was researching information, that's right, for a book I'm working on, basically, it's actually really happening. It's called The Outhouses of Our Forefathers. And I accidentally came across this nugget, that's right, this gem of an article concerning George Washington's bedpan. And it's not a chamber pot, it's a bedpan. But always kind of, you know, where's that dividing line between a bedpan and a chamber pot? Well, you're about to see. And but anyway, gang, here, we'll throw some stuff up here for you to look at on the screen. And have a look at, hey, there's, hi, George, welcome to the live, no, okay. And there's the bedpan, and there you have it. And it's made out of pewter, by the way, but you'll hear more about that here in a second. Now, this is from the Smithsonian.com. It was, I imagine it was actually in the Smithsonian magazine at some point. And anyway, gang, it's titled The Strange Saga of George Washington's Bedpan. And they actually have a little segment underneath the title. It says, even the most mundane of objects associated with the Founding Father have a story. I take great offense to that. What exactly is so mundane about the bedpan? I want to know about the bedpan. But anyway, gang, America's first president had achieved a mythic status by the time of his death in late 1799. And the prized possessions of George and Martha Custis Washington were treated akin to sacred relics. His furniture, swords, clothing, tableware, and more were passed down through his family and proudly displayed in their homes for visitors. But it was not only the attractive decorative pieces that his descendants treasured. As mundane an object as George Washington's bedpan stayed in the family for over a century. How come we don't have any of our ancestors' bedpans? I don't know. An 18th century bedpan isn't all that different from one today. Then it was round and made of pewter with a handle. In an era before plumbing and bathrooms, the bedpan could be gently heated and slipped under the covers of a sickbed. The elderly, ill, and, you know, women recovering from childbirth could use the bedpan without having to risk further injury by leaving their bed. While healthy adults could use a chamber pot which might be kept in a cabinet or attached beneath a hole in a chair seat, the bedpan was designed for the immobile. This particular bedpan was made by a New York pewterer named Frederick Bassett in the late 18th century. It was most likely used by either or both George and Martha Washington at the end of their lives. Because of the meticulous records kept by the family, we can trace the journey of this. Now, they put lowly here. I'm changing it. This lovely item through the 19th century and up to its return to Mount Vernon in 1936. Why was it kept, and who could possibly have wanted it? That's a silly question. I mean, whoever wrote this doesn't watch our show. I tell you, I'd want it. I, you know what? Maybe we should start a collection, you know, actually try to retrieve the bedpans of the Founding Fathers. But anyway, when Martha Washington died in 1802, all of the objects at Mount Vernon, not specifically designated in George and Martha's wills, were sold. Everything from a famous bust of Washington, you know, they sold it for $250, to a tea caddy, $3.25, was recorded in the sales records. The bedpan was likely in the one lot sundries purchased for $29, and thus probably a pretty large lot of, you know, kind of random pieces. Basically, it was purchased by Thomas Peter, husband of Martha's granddaughter, Martha Custis Peter. George Washington never had any children of his own, but he was quite close with Martha Washington's four grandchildren, and Martha Custis Peter was the second oldest of the four grandchildren. The young Martha had married Thomas Peter in 1795, and the couple eventually built a mansion atop a hill in Georgetown. The Peterses were still in the process of setting up their household when they visited Mount Vernon for the sale of the contents of the house, from valuable furniture to kitchen tools to, yeah, that's right, you guessed it, bedpans. Honey, we just bought a new house. Can we go up to the granddad's and see if we can find a bedpan? I don't know.
No.
Okay. But anyway, this sale was technically open to the public, but only family members and close friends purchased items. They bought blankets, carpets, mirrors, chairs, and dishes, not as, you know, famous relics, but as useful housewares. The bedpan may have been acquired for the next time Martha gave birth, or in case of family illness, or it may have simply been thrown in with the sundries, you know, just kind of piece, you know, part of the lot. Martha, like her siblings, spoke reverently of her illustrious grandparents and showed off decorative objects from Mount Vernon. But it is unlikely the bedpan was ever on display. I'd have it right out there on the coffee table. Hey, look, there's a George and Martha's bedpan. No, I don't know. Anyway, gang. Martha and Thomas passed down the Mount Vernon objects, bedpan and all, to their daughter, whose name was, ready, Britannia Wellington Peter Kennan. All right, that's a name and a half. You know what? If they had that name for a YouTube screen name, it wouldn't fit. Plant flowers in it. Nobody will ever know. You know what? When I first saw this, I thought, wow, it looks like a silent butler. You know, we used to, you know, dump your ashes in from the ashtray. Anyway. Here's the name again. Ready? Britannia Wellington Peter Kennan Britannia. Oh, I'm sorry. I was too far that time. Britannia Wellington Peter Kennan. I don't know. Britannia, too, enjoyed sharing stories about the Washingtons and kept careful records of the objects she inherited. She left provisions in her will that her grandchildren would split up all of the Mount Vernon heirlooms evenly, and if possible, keep them in the family. As Adam Irby, associate curator at Mount Vernon, explains, the Peter family elevated many of Mount Vernon's utilitarian objects to the status of almost being religious relics. After all, yes, that's right, gang, this is George Washington's bedpan. In the late 19th or 20th century, the Peterses did a thorough inventory of the heirlooms, placing a numbered label on each one to correspond to a list of some 529 pieces. That's a lot of stuff. By this time, now an era of indoor plumbing for wealthy families and an age of improved medical treatments, the descendants were confused as to the purpose of this mysterious pewter pan. It is listed in the inventory as pewter dish with handle. Okay. Hey, would you like to have granddad's pewter dish with a handle? Here, sonny, have some candy. Could you imagine? Oh my god. Could you imagine using it for, you know, half of a lifetime, not knowing what it was?
No.
Honey, this chili tastes like I don't know. But anyway, by this time, I tell you what, gang. Yeah, it does seem, the article does here mentions that it seems to have been confused with a kitchen item. Oh, goodness. You know how many dinner parties that probably have went through? You know, you're high in society. You have the elegance of being one of the Washington's whatevers. And then, you know, when you have those parties, you know, those elegant affairs, you're going to break out some of the heirlooms. And, I tell you. Miss Paula, I probably did. That's why it turned out so horribly. By this time, even the most ordinary objects Washington had owned had taken on great value. Buttons, pieces of cloth, and kitchen implements were donated to or purchased by the Mount Vernon Ladies Association to put on display in Washington's home after the group took over the estate in 1860. In the late 1930s, Britannia's granddaughter, Agnes Peter Mott, sold basically, quote-unquote, interesting kitchen utensils, originally at Mount Vernon. That was the label. Interesting kitchen utensils. Interesting it is indeed, considering it's yet not a kitchen utensil. Anyway, which quite likely included the mislabeled bedpan. And, all right, here it goes even further. It entered the records, the new records, after being donated as a plate warmer. What's that funny smell coming from the kitchen? A handwritten letter on faded paper in Mount Vernon's files, written around the time of the acquisition from Mott by an apparent pewter expert, finally set the record straight. Hopefully he wasn't like at a dinner or anything. Anyway, he says, I think we must identify this as a bedpan. For nearly 80 years, then, the humble bedpan of George and Martha Washington has received careful treatment as a treasured museum object, and even went on public display in Mount Vernon's Museum in 2010. The bedpan provides tangible connections not only with the Washingtons, but also with the enslaved house servants who were responsible for emptying the bedpan. Moreover, this simple object testifies to the Washington descendants' careful and perhaps quirky stewardship of anything and everything that George Washington owned. And, but yeah, gang, there you have it. George Washington's bedpan. And Who would have thought? I tell you, I want to go to Mount Vernon now, just not only to work on the book, but actually I want to see George Washington's bedpan. Not again. I wonder if we can cook in our bedpan.
We're going to send it to Belinda so she can make AWR meatloaf.
That's it. You know, I'll trade our bedpan for AWR's purple bowl. But anyway, I tell you, try and catch up with chat. Hey, there's B&M Outdoor Pursuits. Hey, York, how are you? And I would have liked to have seen John McEnroe try to serve with that. I tell you. The end of the handle screws off and it's a spout. Oh, okay. And but AWR says he's not eating meatloaf again. You know, strange enough, neither will Sandy. I knew it would get that purple bowl yet. Oh my goodness. Oh goodness, spam. And I try and catch up with chat. You could cook your sausage in it. And that thing's sagging so much, I bet he got wide-eyed awaking every time I don't know. And I tell you, looking at it, how would one empty this thing? You know, it's like trying to get, you know, water out of a tire. You just can't do it. You know, it's always left with that little bit of remnant of water in that tire. Ambient says, is that a stain in the center of the pan? Holy cow. Oh, my goodness. That's an awful hard stain to get out. And I tell you. Mrs. AWR, don't even think about making meatloaf in a bedpan, please. AWR, you're going to get hungry. Yeah. What's up with the handle? Is that when you're constipated? I wonder if it can help. I don't know. The handle's there to hang on. You know, sometimes it just takes a little, you know, to... You know, get it out, and, yeah. Anyway, gang, all right, well, there you go. MS Plus will get that stain right out. I can find a can of Spam. Oh, boy. I would have hated to have seen what I've dented the rim. That Spam! After it comes out, I don't know. I wouldn't sit on that with someone else's butt. Whose butt would you be using? I don't know. Oh, anyway, gang. All right. Well, there you have it. George Washington's bedpan. And I tell you what. See, you know, that's what some people say. They say that history cannot be fun. They say that history is only two-dimensional. And I'll argue that point with my dying breath. That's right. History is not only two-dimensional, and history can be fun if you make it so. And hopefully we have done that this evening. If so, I achieved the goal. But anyway, gang, one more thing, just in case anybody has tuned in late, that one person in particular, just want to say again, happy birthday! Okay. And anyway, you know, if any of her friends are watching, you know, they'll say, hey, you know, happy birthday. And there's a crazy guy on the internet. But anyway, I tell you what. Now, one thing real quick. Since I was doing the research for the book, I have narrowed my list of forefathers to feature. My current grouping for forefathers is outhouses to explore and research and do the spiel on is 20. Now, the number is far higher who deserves their outhouse to be mentioned. However, you know, I have a list of a dozen or so communal places that needs to be mentioning, you know, kind of like Independence Hall. And, you know, our forefathers, I'm sure, used the restroom while at Independence Hall while they were doing their work there. And so basically I want to keep the number of forefathers down to about 20. That way I can also, in the book, fit in the communal places like Independence Hall and et cetera. Because they need to be mentioned as well. And, you know, can you imagine the smell of Independence Hall's outhouse on a hot summer day? After all, you know, July the 4th. Yeah, really. And you got how many people inside Independence Hall and doing their thing?
We'd be 6 blocks away and still smelling.
Oh, it would be Oh, yeah. So not only do you... Oh, my goodness. Now, see, we're bringing it to life right now. Because not only do you have the smell of the facilities, but you have all of these people clamored together, and they had the windows shut. I think it's only been documented they had the windows shut for the Constitution, I believe. I don't know about the Declaration of Independence. They may have, too. And so now you got the heat, you got everybody sweating, and then, oh my goodness, how it must have smelled. Now, see, there's something else that's probably overlooked by history. The odor of that room. No wonder Stephen Hopkins had the fits. I tell you. Anyway, yeah, see, we came right round circle. But anyway, gang. All right, Constitution of Constipation. Oh, good in mood. And anyway, gang. Hey, Madding, how are you? All right, gang. Well, here we go. Time for tonight's giveaway. That's right. Now, tonight we have right down here, we have a coin necklace made and donated by the wonderful Miss Linda Wallace. And also, too, tonight, gang, we'll be including a, that's not the one. It's missing. Oh, here it is. We have a colonial flat button and a shankage. This still has the shank attached. That we will be going in with it. And yes, gang, that's right. Also, too, a pack of Reiser's Treasure Hunting Emporium toilet paper. That's right. It goes wherever you go for when you know it, when you have to go. And anyway, all right, lurkers! All right, lurkers, look alive! Why, you must have something into the chat. So that our random picker bot, Rosie, knows that you are present. And I'll give you folks some time to take care of that while we get set up over here for Miss Rosie. And, okay, there we go. Hey, how about that? She is, wow, Rosie is awake and, oh my goodness. But anyway, what happened? What did I, what, oh my.
Amanda said that she felt the lurker comment was directed towards her.
Coin and card hobbies, my favorite lurker everywhere. Charlie, what is Ben doing on the back of your chair? That's not Ben, that's poop. That's a poop pillow. So anyway, gang, yeah, do be sure, get something into chat and see, for Minter, I thought you meant our Amanda. And,
no.
Now, you know, poor Amanda, now she's like, crap, now I gotta say hi to everybody. I was fine, sitting here quiet, doing my thing, and now I gotta say hi to everybody. Crap! Oh, anyway, hi, buddy. Hey. All right, gang, here we go. We're going to count it down from 5 and select tonight's winner. So here we go. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, bang. Hey, congratulations, B&M Outdoors. York! Well, you won tonight's giveaway, I tell you. Congrats, congrats, congrats. I tell you, you are tonight's winner of the giveaway. See that? I tell you. Rosie must have been impressed by that new sham wow you gave her. Do, that's right, York. Do, send me your address. Send me an email with your address in it. And we'll get that stuff out to you. How about that? Remember the one night that Rosie kept picking the people that bad talker and trash talker and whatnot. BNM, no, you need to send it to me again. Only because we're not allowed to say, per YouTube guidelines, any of the addresses. And, yeah. And why is this my screen frozen? Uh-oh. All right, that's it. This is what you have to look. Oh, there we are. Okay, we are back. Anyway, gang, do not forget. That's right. Don't forget. This Friday, Hoosier Hillbillies on at 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And then Mike usually alternates weeks, so I'm trying to remember. So if he was on last week, maybe he won't be on this week. I don't know, but M.A. Lyman, 8 o'clock on Fridays. Why, it usually comes on. So do check it out. And Mike, if you're here in chat, do throw if you're going to be on this week. And then, gang, Saturday, Mantic Coins at 5:30 Eastern Standard Time. Always, always a good time. And I tell you what, I've got to step up my game with the Mantic bot. I tell you, I think I made about 1 billion coins this past Saturday, and I had to leave early. And but anyway, gang, I tell you what, I've got to step up my game with the Mantic bot. And especially seeing how many other folks have really climbed in the ratings. How many Mantic coins they've got and everything. Holy cow. And then, gang, Sunday morning, Coffee with Liz at 10 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. Always, always a good time for the detectorists and whatnot. And people to gather and meet and etc. And then, gang, Sunday night, Ken Peavy's The Big Show, the biggest coin giveaway on the YouTube. I tell you, that's at 9:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And, you know, it's the biggest coin giveaway on the planet. At least Uranus. No, I'm kidding. Anyway, or Saturn. Okay, we'll clean up a little bit. Saturn. But anyway, who, oh boy, I'm trying to remember who won. Yeah, I'm not done yet. I'm trying to remember who won the Big Show Sunday. I'm drawing a blank. Oh, my goodness. Usually I like to tell them congratulations, and old age is creeping up with me. I can't remember who won Sunday. Darn. Anyway. And then, gang, don't miss it. AWR, American Woodland Relics. Here, he's live streaming on Mondays at 7 p.m. for Monday Madness. And I tell you what, I'll get his purple ice cream bowl yet. But anyway, gang, I tell you, great, great stuff to look forward to. And pop around on the net. And, net, YouTube, net. What am I, 80? But anyway, gang, that is all we have for, huh? That's right, see a penny one. That Mantic Coors bot hates me. Coors? Stupid autocorrect. I tell you what, autocorrect. Is it really a help? I think it's more of a hindrance than anything. Anyway, gang, that is all we have for this week. And we'll probably go on the... We'll do our little finish up here, and then we'll close the door. But anyway, all right, gang, that is all we have for this week. But we will see you right back here next week, Tuesday, 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, for another episode of Reiser's Treasure Hunting Emporium live stream. And I tell you what, gang, thanks so much for tubing in, and we'll be seeing you all across the YouTube land. And, but anyway, have a great, great night. And, again, get out there and, find some treasure. All right, have a great night. We'll see. Oh, wait a minute. We have to do this again. You ready? Well, we have to do this again. Happy birthday! Okay.